Juneteenth is an opportunity, I think, to celebrate, commemorate, and reflect on Black independence in the United States.
Antonin was on the 19th of June. That's why you know to celebrate that day, colored folks. Celebrate that day.
I am Angela Thorpe. I am a public historian based in North Carolina. The Emancipation Proclamation was signed January 1st, 1863. It's signed in the midst of the Civil War, but what we have to understand is that this document or this proclamation does not free all enslaved people. Texas is a hotspot, if you will, for defiance of the Emancipation Proclamation specifically. I think that is part of what makes the Juneteenth story so special. That information is not getting to Texas like it is some other places. And if you're thinking about the Union Army physically advancing through the South, that journey is taking a long time.
And old Marshall didn't tell you no, it was free. Well, he didn't tell them. Wait there. I think now they said it waited them 6 months out of that. 6 months.
June 19th, 1865, Juneteenth becomes a reality. General Granger is one of the foremost people who is responsible for occupying Texas once it falls to the Union and enforcing new realities in Texas and Galveston specifically. And one of the first things that he does is announce General Order Number 3 that informs enslaved peoples that they are free.
On the 19th, you know, that's called it. They said have to give them a big dinner on the 19th. But now we didn't know. I don't hide the other side of the folks, you know, freedom. We didn't know. They just thought, you know, just feeding us, you know. Just had a long table. And just had just a little everything you want to eat, you know, and drink, you know. And that, they say that was on the 19th. And everything you want to eat and drink. Well, see, I didn't know what that was for.
I think what's really interesting, though, in the language of his order is that it encourages or outright instructs formerly enslaved peoples to stay where they are. And so when we think of this concept of liberation, I think it's so fascinating, incredible, and powerful that formerly enslaved men who are now U.S. colored troops are an active part of spreading that information from courthouse to church, the farm, the plantation, to inform formerly enslaved people, hey, you are free, join me, right? You're liberated. But if you've been held in bondage for generations and generations, what does that actually look like? Will you even survive leaving that place? Will you be murdered en route? Will you be killed trying to leave? Those are realities.
Mom and them didn't know where to go. You see, after freedom broke, just like you turned something out, you know, didn't know where to go. That's just where they stayed.
In many places, there's something similar to tent cities, right? Like people are sort of packing up their belongings, creating shelters the best way they know how. I think what is phenomenal, though, about that story is these encampments, these sort of raw settlements, ultimately, in many places, evolve into small towns and small cities in which Black people were able to build community and to thrive. And then there are other Black people who leave, right? They're leaving to find family, to find love, to reconnect with family. As people moved from Texas and moved about the country, migrated about the country, they carried those Juneteenth traditions with them. The earliest Juneteenth celebration took place June 19th, 1866. So they included public readings of the Emancipation Proclamation. They included gathering and food. They included parades, picnics, and they evolved from there. Red is a symbolic color that symbolizes so much. It symbolizes spirituality, strength, resilience, protection. And so that is one reason you see these red foods show up at Juneteenth celebrations. Black people have always had agency. Black people have always made decisions for themselves, even in the most sort of heinous of circumstances. And yet, that is something we are not educated around.